Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How We Vote, Innovation in American Elections by Mitchell Brown and Kathleen Hale. Foreword by Thomas R. Wilkie. Narrated by Chelsea Stevens. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to illustrations, figures, graphs, and tables present in the print and ebook formats of this book. Foreword. The year 2019 marked my 50th year in elections. When I started out in this business in Buffalo at a pretty good-sized local board in 1969, there was no innovation. Voter registration was a laborious process. We had to hire 100 extra people to shuffle cards, put them in heavy binders, and then put them in heavy canisters. The voter registration list was done on an old IBM punch card UNIVAC system. Polling places were literally booths we put in the middle of the street with a pot-bellied stove on one end and the lever machine on the other. Several things that happened along the way turned the tide. Certainly, the Voting Rights Act of 1965 and the court cases that followed it were significant. Lowering the age of voting from 21 to 18 was another. The next big one was the National Voter Registration Act, NVRA. This was followed by the passage of the Help America Vote Act, HAVA. The NVRA changed the way voter registration was conducted and list maintenance was done, and it changed the structure of authority in election administration. We still have confusion and court opinions about list maintenance and how to do this the right way, because the law was written in a way that could be interpreted in different ways. This is true for much of election administration legislation because of the political involvement in the development of legislation. The NVRA was the impetus for the first big expansion of innovation in election offices because it mandated that local offices learn to do these things better and utilize new and emerging technology. The NVRA opened up the door to mail registration, expanded outreach to various public service entities, and mandated a federal form, all of which increased numbers of voter registrations, in turn meaning that boards had to find ways to capture and manage these data. A number of us worked hard with the Federal Election Commission Clearinghouse on Election Administration, which was the predecessor to the Election Administration Commission, to redesign the registration forms through their advisory board, and we worked with literacy experts to figure this out. This was the beginning of innovation in election offices in the contemporary era. The next major event that changed the business of election administration was the election of 2000. Before that election, media and most advocacy groups, and even most voters, did not know much or care about the election administration process. But the 2000 election exploded this. Every news organization in the country was trying to find out how elections were run, and they were all asking similar questions. What was happening with punch cards? Was my voting system okay? Why was everyone not allowed to cast a provisional ballot? The period from 2001 to 2004 marked the politics of the development of HAVA. During this period, the U.S. Senate flipped party control, and because of the makeup of Congress, when the HAVA bill was written, the senior members on both sides of the aisle wanted a piece of the pie. They all wanted their own initiative as part of the bill, which is not unusual for a piece of legislation. There were provisions and sometimes fights about voter identification, punch cards and lever machines, provisional ballots, voting systems for people with disabilities, and the ability to vote independently, and the creation of the U.S. Election Assistance Commission. There were more than 25 other projects given to the commission to complete in a short period, including standards for voting machines. This spurred much innovation. And for the first time in the history of election administration, states were given substantial money to create new systems, buy equipment, and use their resources to support other parts of the election administration system. Together, the NVRA, the 2000 election, and HAVA fostered major innovation and improvement in elections. Education and training were another change that spurred innovation. I was part of the first Election Center Certification in Election and Registration Administration, SARA, Board. The impetus for creating this certification was to enhance the professionalization of election administrators across the country through a partnership with Auburn University. This partnership has led to well over 1,000 graduates, and it continues to be the only professional certification that is specifically for election administrators. By increasing capacity and spurring ideas and change, SARA has become the leading force in training-based innovation. But there is a point at which innovation plateaus, and one needs to concentrate on other things. Many things can be done with computers and technology, but there continue to be critical aspects related to people. People's problems need to be supported through dialogue and working directly with them. Innovation will not solve these issues. This is where education and training remain critical. Elections are and will always be a business that must relate to people. You need communication skills and the ability to work in the community, to reach out and to build and use the resources around you. You need to be able to collaborate, work with advocacy groups, and engage with legislature, all within a political system and environment. People should care about innovation in election administration as a projection of what is going to happen in the future, even with the current slowdown in technological changes as people respond to and worry about cybersecurity. Innovation happens where there are resources and an inclination to take risks. The real pioneers in our business are the jurisdictions and their leaders highlighted in this book. Innovation also drives away the "I like it just the way it is" crowd. You can have tools, but without people to operate them, you do not have anything. To spur innovation, you need resources, people with foresight and vision willing to take a risk, and opportunity. Some of the major periods of innovation in election administration since the start of the 20th century in America have happened because the federal government provided the opportunity through the passage of major legislation: the 19th Amendment, the VRA, the 26th Amendment, the NVRA, and HAVA. And amazing people have been there to grab these opportunities and use the resources at their disposal to make positive change happen. This book shares the work of those people who have the vision, foresight, and zeal to tackle new initiatives and take the risks that others may not have taken. I am very, very proud of my relationship with the people at Auburn University and the authors of this book. In my 50 years in this business, they have been a real shining light. They have been opening doors to the election community and offering this community opportunities to grow knowledge and increase professionalism, and by extension, enhance innovation. Thomas R. Wilkie, Albany, New York, and New Smyrna Beach, Florida, April 26, 2018. Introduction. Innovation drivers and the unique American context. The most recent American elections have been historic events. In the presidential and general elections in November 2016, the presidential candidates themselves were larger than life. Hillary Clinton ran, and lost, as the Democratic Party's nominee and the first female presidential candidate from a major political party. Donald Trump ran, and won, as the Republican Party's nominee and as a populist reformer and political outsider. Election systems and the infrastructure of elections were called into question in new ways. The Trump campaign sounded the drumbeat that elections were rigged all across the country and established a narrative that many votes were cast by ineligible voters. This narrative persists today. An avalanche of media reported that foreign interests, probably Russian, breached electronic security protocols to gain access to the Democratic National Committee's records and election databases in some states, giving rise to widespread concerns about election security. the architecture of federal state election relationships also made the news. Trump won the election by prevailing in the Electoral College, although Clinton led the popular vote by nearly 3 million votes. This was the first presidential election held without the force of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, VRA, requirements for prior federal oversight of state and local changes to election practices, which had been in effect since 1965. This prior review was intended to prevent discriminatory practices that effectively disenfranchised entire minority populations in some states, until they were dismantled in 2013 by the U.S. Supreme Court in the Shelby County versus Holder ruling. The results of the presidential election were widely discussed in the media, and especially among Clinton supporters. However, the new institutional approach to federal oversight, which does not include prior review, received little, if any, public attention. The 2018 elections themselves were by almost all accounts free from any cyber intrusion, although the political debates raged about the interaction of foreign nations, that is, Russia, and deliberate disinformation was promulgated and amplified through Facebook, arguably the largest social media platform in the world. Administrative conditions in states with superheated political races seemed frayed. In the run-up to Election Day, questions were raised in places like Alabama, Georgia, and Kansas about the propriety of elected secretaries of state interpreting election rules for elections in which they were also candidates. At the close of Election Day, close races in states such as Florida and Georgia highlighted recount procedures and deadlines that are rarely in the public eye. Media interest was drawn to process questions about state postmark requirements for the receipt of absentee ballots and other ballots returned by mail, lengths of canvass periods, and instructions given to voters who were issued provisional ballots. Since the 2000 election, Bush versus Gore in 2000, and the Help America Vote Act of 2002, HAVA, election officials in the nation's over 8,000 election jurisdictions have operated in an intergovernmental environment of constant change, including wide swings in political control at both state and federal levels, as well as heightened partisanship at the national level and within states. At the same time, interest in election administration has expanded and has been reflected in thousands of state legislative proposals and executive initiatives intended to control the times and places in which elections are conducted, as well as who can vote and how. Proposals that range from methods of identification to voting technology to periods of early voting continue to be hotly debated in all 50 states, the District of Columbia, and U.S. territories. Established administrative responsibilities, routines, and relationships have been altered by judicial interpretations of long-standing national laws, including the VRA, the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990, and the National Voter Registration Act of 1993, NVRA. New statutory methods of voting for military and overseas voters are bringing some registration practices into the electronic age. During this period, dueling presidential commissions have come and gone. In 2014, the Presidential Commission on Election Administration reported its recommendations for addressing numerous election administration issues and reflected a sense of the field at the time. In 2018, the Presidential Advisory Commission on Election Integrity attempted, without success, to collect voter registration data from the states in order to investigate unspecified claims of voter fraud. The commission was dissolved after states refused to provide confidential information, among other factors. Today, news accounts continue to suggest that elections are in need of drastic overhaul in some regard or another. The popular wisdom is that American elections are either in need of serious repair or are completely broken. We disagree, and we set forth a strong contrary position in this catalog and analysis of change within the context of the American political system and its unique intergovernmental arrangements that grind many good ideas to a halt and helps to spread others, both in the field of election administration and otherwise. In this highly complex and closely monitored policy environment, election administrators face clear challenges as they execute an increasing number of responsibilities and do so with significant success. Election administrators are also at the mercy of policy prescriptions that they are largely unable to influence. Understanding these challenges and how election administrators address them is important because elections are the way that America measures and reflects the quantity and quality of its democracy. The evidence about election performance as a public administration function and as a measure of public management is, in fact, quite positive, despite much media coverage, punditry, and public opinion that suggests otherwise. Perhaps even more significant, the issues that election administrators face in trying to measure performance and success are indicative of larger themes in performance measurement and accountability in public service. This book extends emerging scholarship about election administration by considering election operations as a matter of public administration and by examining how election offices innovate to address complexities, interdependencies, and accountability issues against a fluid political environment. We use the lens of public administration and public management theory to examine the conduct of elections as a contemporary intergovernmental enterprise. We use a mix of data sources and analysis techniques to reflect upon and draw conclusions about the networks of organizations that operate in this critical aspect of American democracy. This book draws upon the essential public sector themes of cooperation, collaboration, governance, and measurement to examine how election officials are meeting the challenges of implementation and compliance in a network of intergovernmental and cross-sectoral interaction, and how these officials conceptualize success. Substantive topics include changes that election administrators have initiated to address challenges in establishing and maintaining voter registration methods and voting options, improvements in voter convenience, support for voting in languages other than English, the integrity of the voting process, and voting system technology. We also focus on the concept of measurement as an overarching and essential dimension of the way that network innovation occurs. State and local election officials are at the center of each configuration and are influenced by political and policy dynamics among national officials, equipment vendors, nonprofit groups, and interested citizens. In each topical area, the configurations of elected officials, appointed staff, back-office civil servants, and street-level bureaucrats, including poll workers, vary with the types of non-election offices and organizations that are involved. These include both elected and appointed government officials and mainline civil servants. These range across the U.S. Postal Service, vendors, language advocacy groups, motor vehicle offices, and more. In some areas, state lawmakers have been particularly active, and in at least one, voting for military and overseas citizens, Congress has recently played a leading role, and courts at all levels are always present and have been highly influential during the period of this study. Collectively, these topical areas present a holistic, though not exhaustive, view of administrative challenges across a range of different intergovernmental and cross-sectoral organizational arrangements, and they offer ground-level insight into the ways that public offices utilize different methods of cooperation, collaboration, governance, and measurement to address their challenges. The solutions crafted by election administrators illuminate the process of public sector innovation and change under persistent conditions of high visibility, public scrutiny, legal review, and limited resources. The components of innovation. This is a book about innovation, change in America election administration in the modern era. Innovation is a complex phenomenon, and as we attempt to reflect the nuances about innovation in practice, we model innovation through the consideration of four interconnected public sector concepts. These factors support and facilitate change, and they also inhibit it. The first factor is politics. In what we consider to be the modern era of election administration, post-2000, the politics of election operations and voter registration have been highly partisan for the most part, and policy choices have focused on administrative practices in particular. Students of the history of election administration and the VRA in particular know that, in very important ways, it took nearly 200 years to achieve this singular piece of legislation, which occurred essentially a century after amendments to the U.S. Constitution established the right to vote for all men regardless of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. The politics of voting also extends far beyond the implementation of technical requirements and implicates the meaning of citizenship as a fundamental consideration of American governance. In a nation of immigrants, the concept of citizenship has always been a creation of law and judicial interpretation. The ability to vote is an essential element of what it means to be a citizen. White men born outside the United States were granted citizenship and given the right to vote in 1790 through the Naturalization Act. Voting rights were later extended to naturalized non-white men in 1870 and to naturalized women in 1920. Students of the Federal System of Government writ large understand that the intergovernmental framework of modern American election administration was cast long ago, at a nation's founding, in divisions of authority between states and the new national government, and descriptions of entitlement to the franchise and definitions of citizenship. The successes and failures over time along the way to the VRA were intertwined in the back and forth of party politics in the United States two-party system and strong regional preferences for states' rights. From the nation's founding, political power to control the parameters of elections was established firmly in the states. Yet, at times, national authority held sway at key inflection points to establish national principles, including the abolition of slavery, the concept of equal protection under the law, and the expansion of citizenship and the right to vote beyond white men born in the United States, first to naturalized white men, then to all men, and then to women. Voting rights are still limited primarily to citizens, although non-citizens are permitted to vote in some local elections, and in most states, criminal convictions carry the loss of voting rights for at least some period, and permanently in some states. Changes were forced by court, and public challenges advanced by advocacy organizations and other nonprofit groups. This political give and take continued as new federal laws such as the NVRA and the HAVA were passed and brought new questions alongside old issues. In the modern era, partisan battles have been waged over such questions as methods of voter identification, whether to classify voters as inactive, and how to remove them from voter rolls. Whether a criminal conviction removes a voter from the rolls, how to draw district lines, and whether election jurisdictions were bound by the conditions of federal review and approval established under the VRA half a century earlier. Federal courts have waded into these and other questions, and their decisions continue to shape the election landscape. The few major federal laws that regulate election systems, and more critically, the absence of unifying federal law for most areas, provide the backdrop or platform for much of the innovation in election administration. Unlike other areas of American public policy, election administration exists without significant federal regulatory oversight. In the breach, local election administrators and their state-level counterparts have developed new and improved methods of operation, based on their own desire to do good work, public desires for more accessible, current, and convenient practices, demands from parties through state legislatures, and court prescriptions imposed on complex practices that have always been locally driven. Driven by the political decisions of federal lawmakers and state legislatures that form macro-level election policy, local election officials have forged new administrative ground through innovation in smaller administrative policies and practice. Their proposals and techniques must survive in a partisan political environment, and as a result, have taken hold in some places and not others. It is also important to note that legislatures are not the only policymakers under the American federal system. Citizens in nearly half the states can exercise direct democracy to bring about political change. One example is Florida Amendment 4, which was approved by a strong majority of voters and restores voting rights to convicted felons. The second factor is professionalism. Professionalism in public administration writ large has evolved with the nation's bureaucracy, especially since the early part of the 20th century. Professionalism in election administration is a latecomer, relatively speaking. But as it has evolved, it has had an impact on innovation across the states in important ways. Today's election administration workforce of public servants and seasonal staff is charged with extraordinary responsibility. For both seasoned veterans and newcomers to the profession, forces are at work to promote and further develop the necessary knowledge, skills, and abilities to do their jobs effectively. Professionalism in election administration, as we demonstrate, has been fostered in significant measure by network interactions among various levels of government and professional and other nonprofit organizations. The third factor is resources. Although rarely statistically significant in the quantitative analysis of innovation presented in this book, the availability of resources is a clear seed for many of the most important innovations that we chronicle. Even the most populous, and presumably the wealthiest, election jurisdictions compete for local resources with every other county, township, and state service. By any estimate we have made, the average election fraction of local jurisdiction resources is significantly less than a half of a percent, 0.005, of the total funding of the jurisdiction, even under the most generous calculations. These local resources are critical because election administration is not supported by federal funds in any significant way. Election jurisdictions typically depend upon revenue decisions made by other government units, that is, counties and states. And it is an understatement to note that election office staff are experts at stretching a dollar. All the innovations described in this book result from the stewardship of always limited public funds. And to be clear, resources are about more than money. Resources, in our conception, include people. Well-meaning, visionary, hard-working leaders, some of whom are able to leverage financial resources, some of whom are able to bring people together, and some of whom are able to see solutions to problems well before the problems themselves were commonly understood. The fourth factor is need. The phrase, "necessity is the mother of invention," is nowhere better exemplified than in election administration. Although under-resourced, election administration is fundamental to conducting elections. Need in election administration specifically, and in the larger environment generally, is spurred by the pressures of voters, community members, advocates, candidates, courts, and legislative mandates, which must be met regardless of available resources, levels of professionalism, and political climate. The story of innovation is also a story about dedicated election officials responding to these conditions. The needs that drive the innovations that we have observed include administrative needs within offices, needs within specific communities, and the overall needs of voters. The innovations in this volume are bookended in many respects by federal voting rights laws, beginning with the VRA, and influenced by political and administrative responses to the presidential elections of 2000 and 2016. Of these two recent election cycles, the first served as the impetus for the wholesale introduction of electronic voting systems and electronic voting records generally. The second prompted considerable exploration of security for online and electronic election systems. The changes that have occurred over more than 50 years illustrate the vigilant attention of public servants, both inside and outside government, among the increasingly diverse citizenry. Any analysis of innovation engages the past, the present, and the future. Each of the innovations presented in this book evolved along a unique arc in time. Some took decades to come to fruition in response to federal law. Some developed only as new technology became more widely accessible and understood. And still others emerged in moments of crisis, whether anticipated, perceived, or actual. Some of the innovations we explore reflect the practices of local election jurisdictions that were seen as best practices and in turn were incorporated into the recommendations of the Presidential Commission on Election Administration. There is no truly unified approach to these innovations across election jurisdictions. This suggests that there are multiple influences at work and that differences in local and state priorities remain. We expect that the factors at work, politics, professionalism, resources, and needs, will manifest themselves differently in each area and at different times in the process. As is the case for election administration generally, one size does not fit all. Considering the unique American context of election administration. It is also important to consider the American federal context and how its unique features support the modern election administration structure. The administration of elections in other federal systems is often less complicated than in the United States. The problems that election administrators face in the United States are different, and the solutions are different as well. Understanding the comparative complexity of all election operations requires delving into constitutional structures, electoral systems, and electoral procedures. Norris, 2004. Election characteristics derive from such elemental factors as the structure of government and decision-making. Direct democracy, republics, or autocracies, federated versus unified structures. For republics, the approach to representation, single-member versus multi-member districts. Electoral rules, first-past-the-post, rank choice, etc. Qualifications for electors and candidates, the administrative structure for running elections, independent electoral bodies, governmental electoral bodies, or mixed approaches, and the amount of authority of these bodies to make, enforce, and adjudicate rules. The U.S. system is a federated republic with primary authority for election administration constitutionally established at the subnational level and implementation vested at the local level. Local and state practices across the country evolved largely independently over time within states, and with a few exceptions, primarily related to suffrage rules. These units continue to exercise relative primacy over the process today. This structure means that the national government may expand or constrain the political opportunity structure that supports innovation, but the state governments also have significant influence over innovation as well. Local and state practices are the heart of American election administration, but such a distribution of power and authority may appear to present significant drawbacks when seen from a comparative perspective. Catt and others, 2014 and 17, write that devolving electoral powers and responsibilities to local authorities without appropriate oversight may make it more difficult to maintain electoral consistency, service, quality, and, ultimately, the freedom and fairness of elections. The United States is a good example of this difficulty. We note that the use of the term devolving in the aforementioned quotation is a bit of a misnomer, because it implies that power and authority were previously held by the national government, which is not the American case. And students of American elections, including ourselves, also beg to differ. We believe that subnational autonomy brings experimentation and innovation, and, to a degree, also protects elections at the national level from external threats like cyber tampering. However, from a comparative perspective, innovation can mean a lot of things. From new laws to changes in institutional arrangements to the mechanics of registering voters, balloting, and counting. Indeed, transparency, efficiency, and accuracy can, in and of themselves, Be innovative. In some of these ways, the United States leads the field. In others, particularly innovations that relate to the use of technology for voting, the U.S. lags behind other countries and will likely continue to do so. Finding comparable countries to use as benchmarks for the U.S. is fraught with problems. If we were to focus on Federalist countries, we might look to places like India, Mexico, or Germany. India and Mexico have independent election boards, and Germany has a national election board with power over disputes. Among countries with governmentally based election boards or offices, like those in the U.S., there is variance over the location of that authority within the federal system. Some, like Brazil, operate at the national and state levels, and some operate at the national and province levels, like Australia and Canada. In others, the local level responds to both national and regional authorities, as in the Russian Federation. Perhaps the only country structurally similar to the U.S. today is Switzerland, but it differs vastly in size and heterogeneity. For more detail, see Cat and Others, 2014. International norms may affect American election administration in the future. Like many countries, we are likely to move toward automatic, or more highly automated electronic, voter registration as technology makes it easier to create voter files from other population data in government offices. But in other ways, the U.S. is unlikely to innovate in similar ways, at least not quickly. For instance, internet-based voting and the use of biometric identifiers for verifying voter eligibility may seem to be just around the corner, given the ubiquitous and visible use of similar technology in other fields where security is an essential concern, such as banking and airline travel. In election administration, security concerns and cultural and political norms will slow or stall the adoption of these innovations. In this way, innovation in election administration depends in part on wealth and the availability of related technology, political will, and culture. Election administration and people. On election day, hundreds of thousands of people express their opinions on politics and policy by casting ballots, in some places in a polling place near their home, in others by mailing in their ballot in advance of the election, and in some by going to a central community voting center. Not all people have the same experiences, and some of them encounter problems or have questions raised for them through the process. In this section, we describe some of these people and their problems and questions, all of which pose challenges for election administrators. We use composite case studies to feature the problems encountered by prospective voters and election administrators, and the ways in which innovations have helped or not. These cases synthesize experiences that we have observed and that have been reported to us, and do not represent any particular person or office or jurisdiction. Based on our research, we feel that the cases fairly represent the range of issues posed by the innovations we discuss in this book. In chapters 3 through 8, we go into detail about the how and the why these problems are, and in some cases are not, resolved through election administration innovations. In the conclusion, we come back to these prospective voters and election administrators and discuss the future of innovation to improve their experiences. Maya Martinez and John Smith. On election day, Maya Martinez goes to her local polling place. Shortly after the last election, Maya married, and recently she and her husband moved across town. When she checks in at her polling location, she shows her driver's license, and a poll worker looks up her name on an electronic tablet computer. She learns that she is listed on the voter rolls by her new last name, but still listed at her former address. Because her new address is connected to different local races than her former address, she is at the wrong polling location for this election. John Smith is next in line to vote. He shares a first and last name with more than 44,000 others in the United States. His last and first names are statistically the most common, respectively. John shows his driver's license in order to check in to vote, which is required in his state as a form of voter identification. His license bears his full name, John James Jeremiah Smith, but his signature appears as John J.J. Smith in the poll books used by the election office. John is also afraid that the state's new voter identification requirement is a barrier to participation targeted at members of minority groups like him and his family. He remembers family stories from the civil rights years about how hard it was to register, about violent intimidation, and how many people simply did not try to vote. His grandmother has a hard time getting around and does not have a driver's license, nor has she ever. However, she is very invested in voting. She was not able to register in time for this election because she could not get a ride to do so in person. The folks at the election office she called suggested she register online through the state portal, but she does not have a computer or internet access at home and could not get to the library to register there. She wonders what kind of documentation she will need in order to register, even if she can find a computer and go online. She was born at home and, in addition to not having a driver's license, does not have a birth certificate. George Marcus and Martha Pendleton. George and Martha are co-directors of their local county's election office, which is led by a bipartisan team appointed by the Board of County Commissioners. With more than 100,000 registered voters, the county is at the midpoint of election jurisdictions in terms of size. The responsibilities of the office include maintaining lists of registered voters and coordinating these data with the state's electronic database. George oversees the integration of voter registration data coming into the local election office, which collects data from the county's Bureau of Vital Statistics, the federal and state criminal justice system, the U.S. Postal Service, and county agencies that issue driver's licenses and provide public services to people with disabilities. Martha oversees voter outreach programs that help voters know where to vote, and she oversees the training program for poll workers who use the voter registration list on Election Day. Martha's training program addresses what to do when prospective voters' names do not appear on the precinct list, and the many reasons that eligible voters appear in the wrong voting location. This training also directs poll workers in the steps to take when responding to voters such as Maya and John. George and Martha have spent the last year meeting with vendors, other local election officials, and with representatives from the state election office to develop proposals to adopt electronic poll books and online voter registration. These proposals are now pending before the state legislature. Claire Michaels and Paul Randolph. Claire suffers from anxiety and depression, and sometimes finds it difficult to leave her house to do anything, much less take the chance of having to wait in long lines with strangers to vote. Voting also seems stressful because Claire has moved frequently, and her polling place is typically in an unfamiliar location. Despite these negative factors, she feels passionately about politics and expresses her opinions on social media and through her online communities. She also wants to be a part of the democratic process through voting, but sometimes it is just not possible for her to get to the polls. Across town, Paul has recently bought a new house. He moved from a town about an hour away, but still works in his old hometown and commutes there 4 days a week, working extra long hours on those days so he can avoid the commute 1 day a week. Election day is almost always on a Tuesday in his state, which is one of his work days. He wishes he could still vote in his old precinct so he could go there from work at lunchtime, but that is against state law. Paul has heard about vote centers in other states, but his state does not have these either. He has yet to transfer his registration to the new county because it is so inconvenient for him to get to the polls at what would be his new precinct. Jessica Sadie and Anthony Smith. In the same state where Claire and Paul live, Jessica, a local election official, wants to be able to implement voting by mail, VBM. but she is working in a state with traditional precinct-based voting and excuse-based absentee balloting. She has gone to every state association meeting for the last 3 years and expressed her opinions about this. And although some of the other election officials across the state agree with her, there has been no traction in the state legislature to move to VBM. Her cousin, John J.J. Smith, has mentioned his worry about their grandmother and thinks she would be more willing to get involved if she could vote at home. Jessica wants to make this change happen for everyone like her grandmother in the state. Halfway across the country, Anthony works in a state election office that has been at the forefront of VBM, vote centers, and other election innovations. And though he is proud of the work they have done, he is also deeply concerned that though VBM seems innovative now, it may not in the future. In speaking with young people in his community, he has become concerned that, as people become more technologically sophisticated, they will be less likely to use VBM and will instead prefer email, social media, and other web-based applications or apps. Anthony would love to be able to move to web-based voting. However, the election security threats associated with that are significant. So, in the meantime, he feels he needs to work to continue the state's VBM efforts while also making it attractive to younger and more technology-savvy voters. Sylvia Moreno and Jim Smith. In 2016, Sylvia, a newly naturalized U.S. citizen, moved to a new state for a job and was considering whether to register to vote in the upcoming election. Her accent is very strong. She wonders whether the election official will actually allow her to register if she speaks. She wants to have information provided in the Spanish language for registration to ensure that she can follow the instructions properly. She worries that if there is no translator to help her register or when she votes, she will not be able to understand what to do, and she does not know if she is allowed to ask for help, or what will happen if she does. Unbeknownst to her, her new county of residence had just been covered for Spanish heritage language under Section 203 of the Voting Rights Act using U.S. Census estimates. But because they had just been covered under Section 203, these materials are not yet available. At the same time, across the country, Jim, a Native American, was trying to talk with his grandfather about voting. A Navajo speaker at home, Jim worked to convince his grandfather about the importance of his vote, especially because so many of the other elders have been passing away and the voice of his generation is so important. He was finally successful when he told his grandfather that he would be able to vote in his native language instead of English. David Chen and Mary Bledsoe. At the same time that Sylvia and Jim were attempting to engage in the voting process using languages other than English, in advance of the 2016 election, David, the election director of a jurisdiction with about 700,000 registered voters, discovered that census estimates added Vietnamese as a new language to its elections. However, these estimates just missed requiring that the jurisdiction include its local Korean community, which has a sizable population and much activism. As the election director, David wanted to go ahead and provide Korean language services as well, but there was pushback related to what he thought were marginal expenses from part of his elected elections board. Media coverage of the need for and interest of Koreans in having language assistance has been intense. Media interest has expanded to cover Polish speakers who want the same consideration. In advance of the same election, Mary, the election director of a jurisdiction that had no requirement for language coverage, was meeting with a community group of citizens who were interested in having information translated into Spanish about the upcoming election that would be available for use in community meetings and on radio stations. Through their meeting, she pondered whether and how her staff of 3 full-time employees could take this on. Jane Walker and Lamont Jackson. In advance of the 2016 presidential election, Jane was trying to decide if she was going to take the time to go vote. She had heard from one of her friends after church one day that ballots for presidential candidate Donald Trump would not be counted, that even though she voted on a paper ballot, when she put her ballot into the machine was secretly programmed to not count her ballot. She did not feel like the possibility of a long wait in line with her children would be worth it if her ballot would not be counted anyway, and she knew that Hillary Clinton was just going to win the election. Elsewhere, Lamont, a first-time candidate in a local election, was trying to understand the process of what happens after the ballots are cast. He had heard from a friend that when that friend ran for office, the count was so close that it took weeks to determine the outcome of the election. Are the results reported on television on election night not enough? What is a certification period? How will he know if he should ask for a recount? Is it true that provisional ballots are only counted if the election is close? How close is that? Joe Stevens and Sonia Rios. Some weeks after the election, Joe, an election administrator, was working long hours going through the process of certifying the results from the most recent local election, which was close. One of the candidates was sure that there was a problem at a precinct where voters were more likely to be in support of her, but the result seemed in favor of the rival candidate, Lamont. In addition, the number of ballots cast in that precinct was unusually high. She sent her lawyers to the election office to argue to the board for an investigation, and Joe is waiting on the board's decision so he can complete the certification process. Meanwhile, at the state capitol, Sonia, who works in the state election office, is trying to develop an auditing program for the state and is in negotiations with a statistician about a sampling procedure to use for selecting counties and ballots. She feels that moving to a statewide audit will enhance the confidence of her state's voters in their elections and will improve people's trust in government. Although she would prefer that all counties in the state participate in the auditing procedure, it is being mandated by the state office. And because the initial budget is not large enough to support a full census of counties, they have to engage in a sampling procedure. Micah Benson. Micah is a college student who spends considerable time on social media, following the threads posted by people he knows on a variety of issues. Since the 2016 presidential election, he has been particularly concerned about election security. Public accounts continue to document that Russians are clearly involved in influence campaigns to target the U.S. and destabilize its democracy. And the question he is currently struggling with is, to what extent? It is possible that many of the memes he saw on Facebook before the election were generated to further the divide in the country and are part of a coordinated disinformation campaign. He has also heard that Russia penetrated some state voter registration systems. He believes, as do many of his friends, that this is far from the whole story. If Russia can hack a statewide voter registration list, surely this means they can change it. And if Russians or other bad actors can do that, this has to mean that they can also get in through a back door and access the counting machines in his county, as well as in other counties around the country, potentially changing the results of our elections. And he knows that bad actors have been successful in denial-of-service attacks on election websites. This must also mean that they can change the results of the elections at the end of the process and report whatever they want. When he went to vote in the last election, the poll workers signed him in on a tablet. He received a paper ballot, but then it went into a machine for counting. How does he know that his name will be on the tablet next time? How does he know his ballot was actually counted the way he intended? The questions Micah most wants answered now are, what is next? And how does he know that anything he is told is true? Alan Parker. Alan was excited when he learned that the U.S. Election Assistance Commission was distributing $380 million in remaining HAVA funds released by Congress to the states, primarily for election security. The commission's notice stated that the funds would come to state chief election officers like Alan, and that the funds would need to be spent rather quickly, perhaps as quickly as within the next few years. He set up a meeting with his senior staff and also with the president of the State Association of Election Officials. He plans to talk with them to determine who should reach out to the state's three different voting system vendors. Local election officials have been very involved through their association in talking with vendors about the next generation of voting systems. Local election officials also have their fingers on the pulse of local emergency management efforts that are deployed in case of a disaster. With the 2020 presidential election cycle rapidly approaching, Allen's chief election officer's office has a few full-time dedicated information technology staff members, and he may need to call upon the state information technology staff for assistance in order to understand more about what election security needs might look like. He has more questions than answers at this point. How can he determine how secure the state and local systems are? What does that actually mean? How expensive will it be to address these things? Will the remaining HAVA funds be enough? And who will know how to address them? Allen remembers an election association conference session from a few months ago, and he recalls a speaker noting that technology security consultants are out there, but may not know much about elections. He thinks that if there are any security consultants who are familiar with elections, they will be swamped with requests for proposals and assessments. He thinks he will need to address at least some of the security issues with in-house staff, and he wonders what skills they will need to possess. Steve Evans and Mandy Rogers. Steve and Mandy are graduate students enrolled at universities in different states. They meet at a conference and they discuss their experiences voting in the presidential election in 2016. As they talk, they realize that their experiences at check-in were completely different, and the time it took was also different. Mandy had to show her identification. Steve did not. Steve waited in line for check-in for 5 minutes. Mandy waited for 45 minutes. They both registered to the Department of Motor Vehicles when they changed their licenses as part of their moves to their respective new schools, and were curious why they had such different experiences when they had that in common. Mandy decides this is an incredible area for research. She suspects that the differences in their experiences are related to the fact that she lives in a poor, primarily minority community, and that Steve does not. She suggests that she and Steve work on a new project together to understand both the similarities and differences in their experiences. Both were unaware that there is a significant and growing body of literature on this topic, with scores of researchers trying to understand these similarities and differences, as well as their effects at a much more granular level. Donna D'Angelo. After the most recent election, Donna, an elected county election director, has been asked to provide information to respond to a media request about how much the most recent election cost the taxpayers. She remembers being asked for data about election costs a few years before. She also recalls very clearly that some months after she provided the information, legislators from her district were up in arms because it had been reported in the newspaper that the cost per voter in her district was twice what it was across the state. The information she had provided was used to rank each of the counties, and those rankings were then made publicly available. It took her months to convince the legislators connected to her county, as well as her voters, that she was not spending money frivolously, and that there was no good way to compare costs per vote across the counties. She was sure to this day, despite her best efforts, that many residents did not believe her. Because of the negative reactions from voters, she was secretly surprised when she won the last election. Now she has been asked by a research team to provide similar data, and she is concerned that if she does so, it will eventually open her up again to unfair comparisons, criticisms, bad media, and pushback from citizens. Plan of the book. This book is not a history lesson, but history matters in order to set the stage. The election administration innovations that we see today would not be possible without the institutional architecture laid down decades before, and they are also shaped by those institutions. This book is also not about election mechanics, per se. Fundamentally, however, the operational details that flow through that architecture and that constitute American elections and the work of election administrators are largely absent from public, political, and academic deliberations about what should happen. The contemporary state of the judiciary and its interpretations of these different approaches is also a critical component. It is only through the details that the innovative nature of the work of public servants in this field can be revealed. We begin our discussion by situating American election administration in its political environment and the intergovernmental system of regulatory and judicial constraints. Chapter 1 looks at the critical requirements of the federal system's intergovernmental architecture that has evolved over more than half a century. This architecture is constructed by the VRA, NVRA, and HAVA, which together define how Americans register to vote. An intricate intergovernmental network of public offices within elections proper interacts with the U.S. Postal Service and other private organizations that support state and local data management efforts to create and maintain accurate voter registration lists. Our ideas about how innovation occurs in complex systems are grounded in a theory of change that we apply to the election administration system. This theory is presented in Chapter 2. It casts innovation in election administration systems as interactions through cooperation, collaboration, and governance arrangements that are characterized by complexity and interdependence and are constrained by requirements for public and political accountability. Voter registration is the first step in American elections. Chapter 3 examines voter registration in the modern era and how it has been shaped by federal legal requirements and evolving innovations, including online voter registration, automatic voter registration, and the use of technology to gather and manage large data sets. Chapter 4 presents the story of how voting by mail, the most common alternative to in-person election day voting, has evolved. Voting by mail has served as a springboard for other methods of convenience voting. It has also become a more nuanced method of election administration in many jurisdictions. Chapter 5 illustrates the role of collaboration in developing similar approaches for working with voters who do not speak English well. Each jurisdiction has a unique complement of voters. However, the challenges of finding voters who need assistance, providing accurate assistance, and forecasting when and how language assistance will be required are similar across the country. There are strong similarities in the solutions and approaches that have been successful. Chapter 6 addresses innovations implemented in evaluating election processes. One focus is on the nationwide requirement for provisional ballots that are cast on election day and counted separately from other ballots. The chapter also examines the emerging role of election audit practices. Chapter 7 focuses on how election jurisdictions are addressing the challenges of voting system technology, including the adoption of a common data format, online voting, the development of new voting systems, and strategies to address cybersecurity issues. Chapter 8 chronicles the efforts of various government agencies and nonprofit groups to conceptualize and measure the success of election performance. It presents various approaches to measuring success, and it discusses their benefits and drawbacks. Two case studies are presented that illustrate efforts to build upon extant approaches and the questions that arise in exploratory research. We conclude by exploring the enduring relationships between organizations in the election administration environment, the current role of partisanship, and the questions raised by considering professionalization and innovation in tandem. In any research project, choices are made about what to focus on and what to set aside for another day. The innovations that we consider cover a wide span and are representative of the most innovative practices in the field. The cases and topics reflect a range and depth of methods for meeting the needs of voters for access and participation while also addressing the challenges of interoffice requirements, massive data sets and data transfer, old and new technology, and threats posed by bad actors. Some aspects of election administration are evolving rapidly, and the issues and solutions presented here can only represent a slice of time. Technology continues to advance, as election offices all across the country are poised to acquire new voting systems. Judicial decisions episodically alter the landscape. Executive branch determinations also have effects. For example, the institutional infrastructure for election security did not exist at all until 2018. The challenges to public administration principles of accountability are apparent. Who is actually responsible for an output or outcome, and who has the authority to get the job done? The way that we think about measuring success in public programs is critical, and yet it is elusive in the election administration arena. The methods we use to collect data for this book also include a wide array of original and secondary sources, which we detail in Appendix C. In short, over several years, we observed elections and non-election day administrative functions through site visits. We interviewed officials from various counties and state and federal offices. We read both formal and informal reports on reform. We perused proposed legislation and court rulings, and we collected existing data from a variety of sources and quantified them. From all these, we developed a mixed method analysis of the drivers of innovation in U.S. election administration. We use this collection of methods to weave a detailed story of how innovation arises in election administration in the U.S. context, and to analyze how the different facets important to innovation work. Innovation is a function of politics, professionalism, resources, and need, and nowhere is this clearer than in U.S. elections. The complex interplay of factors that make change happen in one place but not in another is challenging to model. Our purpose here is to examine an array of areas in election administration where innovation has emerged, or not, with the aim of process improvement, and to examine why, in order to add to the conversation about how elections should be administered. 1. The Federal System and Politics: How the U.S. Intergovernmental Architecture Shapes the Way We Vote. The 2016 U.S. presidential election mobilized 142 million registered voters, thousands of election jurisdictions, tens of thousands of polling places, hundreds of thousands of voting machines, and millions of poll workers. Nearly 40 million people voted at a polling place on Election Day, using one of more than 500,000 electronic voting machines of various types. Across the country, nearly 300,000 machines scanned paper ballots, and more than 200,000 machines presented ballots on a touchscreen for voters to make their selections. Roughly 100 million people cast their ballots early or by mail. Voters were citizens of all races, colors, and genders. They were citizens by birth or had become naturalized after migrating from around the world. Some had experienced periods of incarceration, some could speak English, and some could not. Contrast this with the elections held 200 years ago. In 1816, the 8th presidential election was held over 34 days, from Friday, November 1st, through Wednesday, December 4th. James Monroe, a Democratic Republican, was declared the winner with 183 electoral votes over Rufus King, a Federalist, who had 34 electoral votes. The popular vote was not yet tracked uniformly across states as a method of choosing presidential electors. However, the estimate is that roughly 80,000 ballots were cast. Voters in 19 states around the country used paper ballots that they created themselves or voted viva voce, declaring their candidate preferences out loud and in public. No government election office created ballots or provided equipment. Votes were neither from women nor people of color. Across the states, various requirements were imposed on white men in order to exercise the franchise, including land ownership, residence, and religious allegiance, among others. Fast forward 100 years to the presidential election of 1916. A popular vote total of slightly more than 18.5 million was reported, and Woodrow Wilson, a Democrat, won with 277 electoral votes over Charles Hughes, Republican, who had 254 electoral votes. Punch card machines and mechanical lever machines were used in many locations. The first of these had been introduced just before the turn of the century. By 1896, 39 of the 45 states used secret ballots printed by local governments, reflecting the adoption of the Australian ballot format. The proportion of the population going to the polls had also increased, as the rules for ballot access had also changed over time. The ratification of the 15th Amendment to the Constitution in 1870 permitted males to vote without regard to race, color, or previous condition of servitude. In practice, many states effectively excluded non-whites from voting for nearly the next 100 years. In 1916, women were partially enfranchised. Some women could vote in some elections, and these rights were most expansive in states that began as Western territories. For example, Colorado, Utah, Washington, and Wyoming. Although the 19th Amendment was not yet a reality. Kasar, 2000. More than 100 years later, elections have changed even more. The franchise has expanded to include most all citizens age 18 years and older. Voting today involves complex electronic equipment for registering to vote, for casting and counting ballots, and for transmitting results. Ballots are cast by various methods, including by mail, on days before Election Day and on Election Day, and in traditional polling places or vote centers. Voters register in person at election offices, at a host of other venues, or online. What began as a somewhat simplistic and individualized event using pebbles, voices, or raised hands has evolved into a significant administrative apparatus. Election administration today means designing and implementing new methods of voter registration and casting ballots, and using new techniques to monitor results and ensure transparency. Election officials implement new methods of voting, address cybersecurity concerns, and make it possible to vote in languages other than English. They verify voter eligibility and resolve issues raised by incomplete and contestable identification. Across all these operations, election administrators seek indicators of election success that demonstrate operational accuracy, security, and transparency, regardless of how many voters decide to vote and in which manner. Approaches to implementing election administration activities are shaped by the American federal system and the intergovernmental environment. They are also prompted and accompanied by shifts in political winds, changes in voter perceptions and needs, and resource levels. Universally, technological change is a cross-cutting force. Local election offices carry the weight of election operations and related administration. State election offices have gained authority in recent decades as major policy decisions about methods of conducting elections are made by state legislators. The role of federal agencies in elections is largely advisory. Significant regulatory authority rests only with the U.S. Department of Justice, DOJ, to enforce the federal requirements for voter access and participation. Federal courts serve as a backstop on equal protection issues, but have not overturned many recent state political decisions that define election practices. Among these are the requirements for various methods of identification, including government-issued photo identification, the requirement for additional proof of citizenship in voter registration, and hyperpartisan state redistricting configurations, that is, partisan gerrymandering, that effectively limit the influence of voters in one political party or the other. In the American intergovernmental system, the administrative dynamics are characteristically interactive and collaborative, and reflect significant interactions with the private sector and with government offices that are not devoted to election operations. Many organizational relationships are voluntary, and through these, election officials can seek resources and technical support. Local election officials have considerable latitude to experiment to address local conditions, although they often lack resources and may, in some cases, lack policy authority. To set the stage for understanding innovation, this chapter introduces the institutional context of election administration, including considerations of the federal system, intergovernmental relationships, and major political developments. Innovation in public service occurs within a changing environment that reflects shifts in politics, organizational arrangements, rules, technology, and public opinion. Elections and the American Federal System. The American election administration environment is perhaps.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.